Purpose Haze, a new series featuring Scott Goodson, founder of Strawberry Frog, together with New York Festivals. It will defog purpose through in-depth interviews with those at the forefront of purpose-driven companies. Watch what happens when the smoke clears.
Hi, everybody. My name is Scott Goodson, and I'm here with Ramon Soto. I'm going to explain a little bit in a moment what he does and who he is. I want to start by just talking about the area of health and wellness. And it's an area that has become increasingly important to all of us over the last few years with, of course, COVID and coming out of COVID. And it's touched all of us, our families, our friends, and of course, the marketing world. Here in the United States, one of the largest and most highly regarded health systems is called Northwell Health. They're based in Long Island, just across the river from Manhattan in New York. So officially New York, for sure, and the largest employer in New York State. One of the, I think, incredible thinkers in this space, innovative, challenging the status quo, bold thoughts, which you'll see in a moment, is this gentleman, Ramon Soto, who is the Chief Communications and Chief Marketing Officer of Northwell. Welcome to the
great to be here, Scott. Always a pleasure chatting with you. And I'm looking forward to talking today about purpose and how we activate purpose and how we create value for our customers who we interact with every day. A little bit about Northwell. Northwell is the largest employer in the state. We have about 85,000 employees, about 23 hospitals, about 900 ports of entry for consumers to interact with us. And every year we treat about 6 million New Yorkers. So we're ubiquitous with healthcare in the New York market. And to do that, we try to do it in a very different way, thanks to the partnership with Scott.
So creative marketing doesn't always go hand in hand with health and wellness.
Yeah.
How has purpose, we're gonna get to what your purpose is and all that.
Sure.
How does purpose allow you to really put your best foot forward in terms of how you communicate and really break through to people?
Yeah. There's a couple of pieces to that question. And I think it all starts with perspective. First of all, you would think that healthcare in any market, forget New York, is purpose-driven. It certainly is mission-driven. But it's hyper-competitive in the New York marketplace, and you see most of the marketing and advertising to consumers tends to be on the transactional side. We're the number one at this, we're the best at that, come visit us if you're having chest pain. The reality is when you take a purpose-driven perspective, you can take a step back and really think broadly about what health empowers. And if you think about it, it's fundamental. Consumers are more aware of this now than ever. We've just been through a pandemic, and healthcare is historically a low interest category. We've emerged the pandemic with it being acutely aware in consumers' mind. And think about the territory it empowers, your life, your love, your passions. Think about what happens if you don't have your health. When you tie that rich medium with the ability to interact on a purpose-driven basis, you can engage with consumers in really fundamentally different ways that for us have helped differentiate the brand.
So let's look at one example. Very recently, you leaned heavily into a gun violence prevention
campaign, yes.
Campaign that started in New York and then grew and grew and grew. And the last count, there were thousands of hospitals and clinics and medical centers that have joined in a national movement. And I'd like to roll the short film here.
So we just wanted to ask, and it's totally cool. There's no issue. The tiger.
And we were just wondering if he'll be locked up.
Yeah, will the tiger be locked up for the whole time?
Absolutely. Oh, absolutely. We never let him out with kids around. Not even our own.
It doesn't kill to ask about unlocked guns in the house. Right? Guns are now the leading cause of death for kids.
Now you saw that, and We can talk. It's magic. On the snap of a finger, we watch that film. But it's a serious issue.
It is.
How does that relate to what you're trying to do in terms of your brand and in terms of your purpose? And
Scott, such an important question. First of all, we really try to differentiate the brand because there's such good competition and New Yorkers have great choices for care. One of those ingredients is to really be where consumers are in their mindset about issues affecting themselves, their families, and their health. And gun violence is one of those things that it's really on the social side of health versus the physical side of health. But we've seen an astronomical increase in children coming, presenting themselves to our institution that are victims of gun violence. And from a personal basis, our CEO really wanted to take a different approach at talking about this issue, organizing around it, and going upstream and trying to affect why people present themselves to our institution. We did a ton of research with you, as you know, to understand the dynamics of this topic. And it's such a slippery slope from a political standpoint. You know, you can venture into the space and then all of a sudden the debate turns into a Second Amendment issue. And we needed to make sure that we redefined this category into what it was, a national healthcare epidemic.
And can I just pause for one sec?
Absolutely.
I just wanna make sure everyone understands. So here in the United States, their Second Amendment says that everyone has the right to bear arms. So instead of going into like a message that could be perceived as either for or against it, it's taking a completely different tact.
Yes.
So I just want to explain that.
And just to expand on what Scott just stated, there are over 400 million guns in the United States. There's over 320 million people. You know, it is codified in the Constitution. Guns aren't going anywhere. So how do we address the issue without making it a political conversation in a world where there's such tension on the political basis? So it actually took a bit of bravery, but we did this from an outside-in standpoint. We really tried to understand where the consumer's mind was, how important the issue was. And what we used for our motivation was a data point that happened in 2019. And it was really profound. In 2019, we crossed the Rubicon as a nation, and guns became the leading cause of death for children in the United States.
I mean, that's a pretty insane statistic. So don't underestimate how profound and on us this is. It's just, I wanted to make the point that it's crazy for most people out there that are,
they
don't come across guns in their day to day. It's just,
it is, you know, the United States is very unique in this fashion. And if you were to ask an audience like you of any Western industrialized nation, automobile accidents are typically the leading cause of death, but literally they've been on the decline because of the safety of what we drive now. And in the US, we crossed that threshold, and it's an absurd place to be. There's a need to really bend the curve there and drive social change that benefits all of society. So we had to treat this as a safety issue. We had to treat this as a healthcare issue. That absurd statistic gave us creative energy to go in this route, inform the marketplace that we've hit this threshold, and then compel consumers to come in and partner with us to get this to a different place.
So the purpose gives you the permission to lean into a social issue that's highly relevant to millions of people and do it in a way that is sensitive to a lot of complex issues that some of which we talked about. It lets you be highly provocative and bold, but in a way that feels right.
Oh, absolutely. There's a tremendous amount of emotional energy when you actually look at these hidden injustices, particularly in healthcare, that are just under the surface. It is not widely known that we've crossed this threshold and guns are now the leading cause of death for children. There are dozens of those injustices that become fodder for how we tell the purpose-driven story in the marketplace.
So the purpose lets you play in that space while you go through that process as a marketer, let's say, as a communications marketer expert, you look at that and you say, okay, there's opportunity here for us to deepen our relationship with our own people working inside our organization, and of course all our people who use us and those that we want to bring into our group, because you can talk about things that people don't know, like it's the largest cause of death. But what also I think you found out was that people on both sides of the gun issue both agree that having an unlocked gun in your home is nuts.
Yes, profound insight. And this had to be research-driven and it had to be fact-based driven. And as you just articulated, we talked to a number of consumers in the New York market and nationally. We talked to gun owners, we talked to Republicans, we talked to Democrats, independents, victims of gun violence, the police department. We really wanted to make sure that we understood the sensitivities, but where there was common ground. And the common ground was really exposed when you shifted the conversation to safety. I remember one verbatim from a research study that you helped us field in market. It was a woman in Alabama who we were having an interview with. She was a gun owner. And her quote was, if someone is against this campaign, they shouldn't own a gun because this is about the safety of our kids. The truth behind this is there's this natural instinct to protect our children. And we don't know all that there is to that we need to surround them with love and protection. Once you expose the healthcare issue,
yeah,
you unleash the natural instincts of parents to protect their kids. And that was a universal truth across all audiences. It was very powerful and very satisfying to see that the police officers we talked to, the victims of gun violence, regardless of where you were from a political standpoint, they were all very supportive of this campaign and the safety aspect of it.
So purpose lets you be sensitive, lets you be relevant, lets you be bold, lets you, I mean, you saw this film, highly creative.
Yes.
Or say creative, I don't want to, but creative. But
I think it's okay to say highly creative.
How do you navigate that type of work through, you know, the largest employer in New York State?
Yeah, it's actually, I think you have to build the right fact base because you're stepping 2 to 3 degrees of freedom beyond where an organization is historically comfortable. The great thing is it starts from the top down, and we have a CEO that really believes in dealing with this national issue. He started our Center for Gun Violence Prevention 5 years ago, so this isn't a new phenomenon. What gives this currency and credibility is that it is real at Northwell. We're not just talking about it as an issue. We are doing things as a health system.
So you do it. I mean, it's hard, but that's what you do. You do these difficult things.
Absolutely.
So purpose has let you be relevant, be bold, lets you engage in a highly creative way, as we saw with the Tiger video. That's not the first time. I mean, this is a tough thing that you do. You lean into these tough issues. Obviously, they generate positive returns on that and from a marketer's perspective. But before Tiger, you did a whole effort towards women and women's health. Can you talk a little bit about
Absolutely. That? Absolutely. We mentioned earlier about these hidden injustices. So when you look down history, men and the male physique have been the metaphor for health. And that permeates all aspects of healthcare, including healthcare delivery. Women have been treated as smaller versions of men. Pharmaceuticals are titrated based off of weight and body size. But the reality is that your metabolism is different based on gender. Your body chemistry is different based on gender. How your organs perform is different based on gender. Northwell created the Katz Institute for Women's Health to treat women differently in terms of how they should be consuming healthcare. And we've turned into the largest provider of women's health in the New York market. When you overlay purpose to this, it allows us to tackle this hidden injustice on how women are treated differently in healthcare, and they shouldn't be. What made it powerful was observing the hidden injustice, sharing that hidden injustice with society, but authentically having the resources to bend that curve, to change the dynamic, to actually show how women's health should be treated differently. And the Katz Institute credentials thousands of physicians who are specially trained to administer women's health by specialty differently within our health system. It's a very powerful platform for us to be. And purpose overall is a piece of the brand equation. We still have to talk about the physical health aspect of what we do, but the purpose-driven aspect allows us to come at it in a way that challenges consumers to raise their health overall, allows us to express a brand promise that raises the health of healthcare for all New Yorkers. It's really deeply embedded in who we are and how we go to market. You know, our value proposition is centered around better health for all. It's a very simple value proposition, and that platform allows us to really lean into purpose as both a differentiator and as an authentic representation of who we are and how we go to market.
There has been many years of time and money and manpower, brain power put on that, you know, executing what you just described. This recent gun violence, then the women's health, and before that, you also leaned into children's health, which yes. another area which hasn't really been focused on. We have pediatricians, and we take them to the, because they're probably local, and they're, it's about, you know, how easy it is to get there. Really, for the first time, you made people think about what it means to go to the right type of place and what type of rights kids should deserve when they go to these places. And we'll just show this last clip here.
The default in medicine has always been man. Problem is, more than half the population are women. We have been understudied and misdiagnosed for too long. So Northwell created the only network of experts devoted to every aspect of women's health. When we raise the health of women, we raise everyone.
Be honest with me. I'll heal better.
Listen to me, and I'll heal smarter.
Talk to me so I understand, and I'll heal faster.
If it's gonna hurt, just tell me.
Include me, and I won't just heal, I'll help others.
Northwell created the Cohen Children's Bill of Rights because when we raise kids' voices,
I'll heal better.
I'll heal better.
I'll heal better.
We raise everyone.
So can you briefly just talk about that and just summarize at the end what the sort of overall impact has been for Northwell as a result of this approach
sure.
that you've taken?
Yes. So the pediatric work is probably one of my favorite pieces. It's so uplifting, and it really shows the authenticity of how Northwell goes to market and how engages the patient in terms of their own caregiving. The secret sauce there was really observing how we listened to, in this case, children, as part of their healthcare delivery. And the metaphor for us was a patient bill of rights that we used as a platform to talk about how we see children differently and how we take the journey with them differently. It created that powerful commercial that you saw. Highly differentiating work, really purpose-driven at its core. Taking the journey with the individual, it really expressed Northwell as a different brand when it comes to pediatrics. All the work that we've just mentioned, you know, we don't do it for the sake of just doing that work. We do it for the benefit of the organization and the benefit to consumers that we talk to. And the pediatrics work was a great example of the power of marketing appropriately and authentically to the marketplace. Northwell moved from the number four pediatric brand in the New York market to the number one brand in the pediatric market. On the women's health side as well, Northwell moved from the number three women's health brand in the New York market to the number one brand in the New York market. The gun violence campaign is still very fresh. It was launched in October. It's been in market heavyweights for the first 3 months, and it is on sustaining mode right now, but the data is super powerful on two dimensions. One, consumers who are exposed to the advertising are three times more likely to ask if there's an unlocked gun in the house to actually help us bend that safety curve. That's probably the best metric in terms of its success. Secondly, the brand metrics are super powerful. So like any organization, we manage our brand across a whole host of dimensions. And we've seen these extreme pops in terms of those key measures for us. The key KPIs for the campaign have all been exceeded. We think it's creating a tremendous amount of brand love while it's doing good and well for society.
Actually, I want to jump in with two quick last thoughts before we end. So in addition to all that, you've been very innovative and very responsive. And I just give two examples. And then you can briefly summarize why you do those things.
Sure.
So first of all, when the Ukraine war happened and Russia was bombing hospitals, you called me up and said, we should do a documentary. We're actually sending, we're doing telemedicine with hospitals in the Ukraine. This is not right. And we sent a film crew to Ukraine. We did a documentary called Two Wars.
Тепер стало дві війни. Війна з хворобою і війна України з Росією.
It's a fascinating documentary about children and the need for care and what happens when there is no care. But in addition to that, you were the first, as far as I know, health and medical system to do a series on Netflix called Lenox Hill. And you've got a couple of other new shows in the works, one that's about to break shortly, which you might mention briefly. And finally, you've been holding these massive veteran rock concerts in Manhattan with the Imagine Dragons, where if you've been in the military, you can, on Veterans Day, or Veterans Day, you can get in at a significantly reduced cost. And can you just talk about
where
does that come from? Like, that's not your health and wellness CMO. Like,
so,
where do you get this from?
You know, we're a big believer in not following anybody when it comes to healthcare marketing. I think the category can do so much better and needs to. And one of the fundamental principles is, how do you engage with consumers differently? I can't buy enough media to just talk at them. How do I get them to experience the brand? And while they're experiencing the brand, how do I invite them in to see all the unseen things that happen in these very special places, the lifestyle, the mission-driven nature of providing care, the physicians who are really unique individuals, and how they live their life around healthcare, the nurses who are really profound in terms of their commitment to the marketplace and the incredible things that they do. The fact that this industry can mobilize, and as we saw through COVID, run towards the flames to keep us all safe. As Scott had mentioned, we experimented broadly on engagement platforms that pulled people in and allowed them to see other sides of Northwell. So we did our first Netflix 9-episode docudrama called Lenox Hill.
Lenox Hill was a sleepy little Upper East Side hospital competing with some of the greatest health institutions in the world.
You cannot choose what comes at you here. It's like the front line.
We deal with death and dying.
I don't even dare to imagine what I'm going to encounter on any given day.
I don't have cancer.
Well, that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about.
I think there's such a thing as a calling.
Yes, that's good.
This is the space I'm supposed to be in.
There's just so much emotional energy that goes into doing this. The pressure really is intense sometimes.
Well received in the market. Led to really profound increases in brand stature, not just in the New York market, but across the US and frankly globally. That led to a second engagement. We finished filming and editing. We'll be airing later in March. We did a COVID documentary in collaboration with Hulu and National Geographic's called The First Wave. Really profound opportunity to have the world understand what really took place in New York in those very dark days. The reality of what became very politicized. And it's become a very important artifact of history. We've just wrapped up filming with HBO a behavioral health documentary. So one of the knock-on effects of COVID is this burgeoning behavioral health crisis that is brewing in America. A hidden injustice that we have to expose, and we have to have a dialogue about it. So the brand can very boldly move into these territories and use our platform to provide the right content to stimulate these conversations. It again creates brand love, but it moves our ability to interact with consumers in a very profound way. And because of that, we're a very differentiated brand. We consider ourselves a challenger brand in the New York market. We have brand permission to do things that other brands might not do in terms of how they engage consumers.
This has been a wonderful conversation. Very much appreciated. We look forward to more exciting and innovative work coming over the next few months, years ahead.
Well, Scott, thank you for the opportunity to share. And I hope the audience found this content super interesting and appreciate all your partnership.
Yeah, awesome.
Thank you, brother.
Thanks for everyone for joining us. And if you have any questions, please hit me up. I'll try to answer those and stay tuned for the next episode.